Hello everyone, Zen here with another episode of Wildcard Workshop. Today we are going to be looking at scalability and setting up config options for our mods. These will be the settings that you can set in the game's INI file. I'll show you how to initialize them, how to call them in-game in Blueprint, and then how to use them. Now we're not going to cover it in this video, but there is also another way of doing game configs using what's called UE4's save game system, which allows us to serialize an object, a custom object. We'll cover that in a different video, but using that, we can actually make some interesting in-game UIs to manage mod settings. So if you remember our mod from a few videos ago, our Dino Shrine mod, this was just a simple mod that adds a craftable structure that spawns a dino. We're going to modify this a bit so that it's configurable. All of those little bits and bobs like selecting the creature and setting the offsets, those are going to be configurable via the INI config. All of these options here. And I added an option for show visual effects so that that particle effect is an optional bit that people can turn off. So let's look at how I did this. Pop over to the graph. So I did everything within the Dino Shrine BP. And the files will be included with this video as well, so that you can just download them in case you didn't already build this yourself from before. So in this, you will find that most things are the same, except I have added a first of all, I added this isPreview structure branch. Basically, this will gate it so that all of this code will only fire if the structure's actually been placed. So from there, after the switch net authority, I added a sequence. Now, the second part of the sequence just continues on to all the code that we made before, this whole section right here. But the first part of the sequence goes up to this big block up here. And this is where we set up and pull our config options from the INI. So the way you do this is first you need a reference to the game mode. Now this is important to understand that the game mode only exists on the server or authority. It does not exist on remote clients. So this has to be done on the server side, which here it is, as you can see, dedicated player server only. From there, you cast it to shooter game mode, and when you pull off these pins, you will see some options. Init bool, option bool, init option float. These init option nodes are what we can use to initialize the starting value of our config options. So you give these a section and an option, and the option is the left-hand like the variable name of the config option. And there is a catch to these for these init option nodes. These will only add the option to the config file if the value being fed to it is a non-zeroed value. For instance, if the value being fed to this init option bool is false, it will not get added to the config file. If this float is zero, it will not get added to the config file. It has to be a non-defaulted value, like default for that particular type. And I'll kind of show you what I mean in a bit after this has been run. It'll generate the options in the config file. Now, after it does this init, which basically this is for if the options don't already exist, add them. This will only also operate if the option is not already in the config file. If it's already in the file, these don't do anything. So it won't override any existing settings. It'll only set the defaults if they're not already there. So it's extremely useful for that and a safe operation. Now, after we've initialized our config options, the second element in the sequence will actually pull them. But here we get the string option, which I have set up to be the class path of a blueprint, and then it'll call this BP load class. And it will load the actual class from that string path. As long as it's a valid primal dino character class, it'll save the class to the dino spawn class variable, which we use down here to actually generate our dino. From there, we get the add visual effect bool and assign its value, and all of our delay and offset floats, all from the INI. After that, it goes right back down to this sequence and starts this section here and continues on as we wrote it from the previous mod. I did add the branch and show visual effect bool here so that we can gate off adding this buff so that it's an optional thing. And this is all there really is to setting up INI config options. Now, again, remember, server side only, authority side only. Dedicated server and player server. It will not run properly on a client. The game mode does not exist on a client. Ever. I'll kind of show you how it's set up here. Let's go ahead and run it. Oops. Give that a save, otherwise we're going to be waiting forever for the plan editor. So make sure that your primal game data is set in the map. Hit play. Go ahead and give yourself the structure. And place it. Boom. And you'll notice it's not a turtle, and that's because I've already preset the value of that dino class option in the config. The others, however, were not. And I'll actually show you a before and after of that. Let me pull up that file for you real quick. So if we come down here to the bottom, you'll see I've got all the options already in here. It actually added them when I hit play this time. No, these were already in there from when I was testing. So what I'll do, just to show you, is I will remove those and save. Close that down. We'll hit play again. That down. Oh, still worked. Then we will open the file again. Scroll down and oh look, there they are. Added them right back in. And then if I go like false there, you'll notice there's no spawn X offset in here. And that's because the value of spawn X offset in our shrine BP is set to zero. So it won't add it unless we set this to a different value. For instance, if I set it to 50 now and hit save. So you should compile probably after doing this. Even though it's just a change to the defaults. And then you'll see it has added the spawn X offset right there. And then for some reason, even though it was a change to the defaults, it only did that after I hit compile. And the reason for that is that it did not load the config file into memory for changes until I did that. That's sort of a catch for with working with the config options in the dev kit, is that the config file is loaded into the dev kit when the dev kit's, like when it's forced to, not when you start Pi. So you may need to do some actions that would force it to be loaded again or restart the dev kit. By the way, the DevKit's config file can be found in your Arc DevKit folder, projects, shooter game, saved, config, windows, and game user settings.ini. And that's where you will be able to find the one for the DevKit itself. Or that shows you how to set up config options for your mods. You can use that to set up any kind of scalability between your mods, whether that be something like experience bonus rates for custom systems, or how many dinos to spawn based on players that are around. You could use it for virtually anything. In another one of my mods, I use it to allow people to adjust the stat scaling of some buffs. Pretty much any base types like bools, floats, ints, or strings can be made into config options, which in turn, with some clever usage, can basically allow you to use the config for almost any variable type in UE4. And as I said, I will be adding the files from this video into the video description. Feel free to add your own options, play around with them, experiment and see how they work with your own ideas. And that's how you set up config options for your mod. Using these configuration options, you can make your mods more scalable so that server owners can fit them to match their specific server environments, and also get them to mesh better, balancing them with other mods that have different stat scales and things like that. Now, I mentioned that there is another method of doing this using in-game UIs. We're not going to cover it in the next video, because I realized I forgot to actually cover a video on uploading a mod. So that's what we're going to do in the next workshop video, is this mod that we just finished working on here today. We're going to upload it, and I'm going to show you some cool things that you can do with uploading your mods to the workshop, and how you can set up test branches for your mods and keep them hidden so that you can test and make sure that your mods are stable before you release them to the public at large. And this is extremely helpful in preventing people from becoming upset over mods, you know, losing data or breaking other things because the cook didn't go quite right. So this will all be extremely useful information to get. But we'll cover the in-game UI means in a future video, because we also still have to cover using UMG in the ADK. So we'll kind of step our way there. It's a little bit more of an advanced subject that kind of puts a few together. So we'll want to piece it all together a bit before we reach that point. And until next time, happy modding!